today is the 1W, week one, Wednesday. Sorry if the preparation document looked like it was from last year. It's pretty much the same content, so there's no trouble with the quiz. But I'm having trouble with CCLE and linking to Dropbox, so it was supposed to have automatically updated when I changed the document, and it seemed to be for the first assignment and didn't for the next one. So that's what happened there. So hopefully I'll get that fixed for the rest of the book. Something else? Preparation 1F. That's the preparation for Friday is posted on CCLE. And today is our first assignment. So you can choose to complete either the assignment for today, which should already be posted if you have access to it, or you can wait until next time and do that assignment. The assignment that is assigned today, 1W, is going to be due on Monday. The 1F assignment is going to be due on Wednesday. So you get to choose between the two. Office hours we have on Friday, not today. I'm moving offices, but I might consider adding office hours on Wednesday. If you can't make either of the office hour times that I have, let me know so we can figure out something that you can work with. What questions do you have on either announcement type? Let's start with announcement type stuff, logistics. I've got my tickets today. I don't remember that yet.
Are there actually midterms in this class?
Are there midterms? No, there's not.
Oh, okay. Because I think the facility is not listed as our teacher.
Yeah, yeah. No midterms. Yeah. 60%, I think we went over on the first day, 60% final, 60% assignments, 20% quizzes, and 20% final exam. Others? How about content? You're going to be quizzed on it, yeah.
Can you go over how passing a lambda function into the sort function works?
Lambda function into the sort function.
Yeah.
Well, can you remind me what the, I'm not sure about the lambda, a lambda function. So the sort function is Python's built-in sort, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Okay, not the one that you were supposed to, I think that maybe on the next assignment or on this assignment were you asked to write a sort function? I think it was on this assignment you were asked to write a sort function, so not that one. So the sort function, you'll have to remind me, the lambda function that goes in is supposed to compare two operands. Can you tell me whether it's supposed to be a less than relationship or greater than? Does anybody know? What's that? In ascending order? Well, that's how it sorts. It's just a question of what operator it ends up using. Well, sure. First, let's consider, I'm not sure if this is going to be the exact right answer, but typically sort functions need to compare elements, right? They need to determine if A is less than B. So I'm guessing that the function is you have to define, let's work with a regular function first, and then we'll go to lambda function. Because lambda function is the same as regular functions, it's just they're declared it all in one line, right? So compare, maybe, is what you call it. In a lambda function, you're not going to have to call it anything. You're just going to save it in a variable or a reference to it. And you're going to put in what the arguments are. Probably take it in an A and a B because we need to compare the two. And what you're probably going to do is going to return whether A is less, you know, if that's what you want. If you want to, if it's asking for when A is less than B, it's as simple as this. However, it says sort in ascending order. So what do you do if you want to sort in descending order? You can change this to B is less than A. So you redefine what less than means so that when it tries to sort things in ascending order, well, now it's really just sorting in descending order. Right? So that's the basic idea of what it wants. I'm not certain if this is exactly what it wants because I just didn't memorize that. But you can also write a lambda function. And so we can just say F is lambda. And then we put the arguments, right, for the lambda function. Is there a, there's no, I'm getting confused with MATLAB. Is it just, yeah, I think you just write A and then B and then colon, and then A is less than B. Lambda functions, actually, I haven't worked with super recently myself because they're not actually considered PEP 8 compliant style. And I think at the end of your preparation, there was a little bit about PEP 8 compliance. And so if you were trying to submit your code to like a project, like you're trying to submit code to sci-fi, I've done that before. And don't want you to use climate funds. And you see how this function basically is exactly the same thing. We didn't give it a name, we stored the function in a variable. So I guess this kind of becomes the function's name, because then we can call f of, you know, 1, comma 2, and it will return something, just like we called it there. So it basically becomes the function's name. This is kind of similar to function references or function pointers in C++, if you got to that. And let's see, it takes the argument list, right? And then we also specify what it returns, but we don't have to give a return statement, because a lambda function is just a one-line way to explain. Can somebody confirm this is the correct syntax? It's not? Can you tell me what it is?
It just said invalid syntax.
Okay.
Does it have the parentheses?
It doesn't have the parentheses. So you just say lambda AB. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Sorry about that. Is that correct? That's what you're going to say? Thank you. All right, you said it doesn't have the parentheses, right? A lot of people said it. I'll share a ticket for everybody. I'll cut it up into little pieces and give you each one. Sorry about that. Syntax is not necessarily my forte, but you'll see that, I mean, that's the thing. Is if you get it in a computer, you can't figure it out, I'll Google it. But it's the concepts that are important. And the concept here is that there's a direct relationship between a lambda function and its counterpart, an regular function. Does that answer your question? Okay. Yes?
So for a single star parameter, how do you separate that parameter? You can have multiple parameters for single star. How do you separate it from the other parameters? How do you know these are these?
The single star ones go at the end. So if you have a parameter list, and the single star, it takes in a bunch of them, right?
Yeah.
Right? So if you write a function, def a, b, and single star, then all the other parameters, you always put the one with the single star at the end. You can't start having like comma C after this, because as you're saying, it doesn't know which one is C and which one is the single star. Does that answer your question?
It doesn't have double stars behind it as well.
You can have a double star behind it. I have to brush up on that, actually. I don't really remember. That's not a very common case. Yeah.
Can you explain exactly how the arbitrary argument list works? The one with the file separator and then star R?
That is not going to be on the quiz, so let's hold off on that.
Okay.
Yeah, I know that this part, I guess the single star stuff and the double star is a little bit new. Unfortunately, it's not on the quiz, so I wouldn't worry about it. I'm not going to emphasize it too much in the course. You just might find it useful. So consider it for reference. Yeah. Oh, in the front of it. Thanks. You had a good question, yes?
So, are arguments after the double star right up with the math?
So, let's talk about that after the quiz, because the questions about the single and double star are going to answer this. Yeah.
Are the situations where a lambda expression is necessary, or can you always program it?
In Python, you can always get around using a lambda function. Yes, because you can define a function within a function. So in some programming languages, I don't think that you can define a function within a function, and so then it becomes important. Like lambda functions are like anonymous functions in MATLAB, and so in MATLAB, sometimes it's very useful to be able to do this. But in Python, we could def compare, right? And forget about this. You can write f gets compare. And now we can call f of 1, comma 2. So def is just a longer way of writing it, allows you longer things. But this could all be inside a function, which is sometimes what lambda functions are used. Let's say that you wanted to use, let's say you wanted your compare function to always compare to the same b, right? So I define b up here, b is 10. And we just always want to compare a to b, right? And so sometimes lambda functions are used for that. So when it's like inside a function, or that's sometimes how lambda functions are used, but you can use regular functions for that. So it's not ever required. Yeah? yeah, so that's what lambda functions are for, right? So you can pass a function pointer or reference into another function. Well, we can pass this f into another function. And we've defined it by with the def. We didn't use a lambda function. So we didn't actually need a lambda function for it. Compare is not a lambda function just because we assigned it to f. It's just how it's defined. So that's a good thought. Yeah, sometimes we want to do that. Did I give you a ticket?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. What's next? Let's talk about star arbs and double star stuff after the quiz, because there's not going to be on the quiz. Yes?
So for the swap exercise,
yes,
from the preparation, so I'm just wondering, there's like no way to, so for example, if you want to swap A and B, there's like no way to swap A and B themselves if they're like individual trees. So you can only return, right, if you flip it off.
No, well, no, take, no, you don't just have to return it. You can say A comma B gets B comma A. This is a valid line.
Yeah, but I mean, like, if you define a function that's called swap.
Yeah.
And then there's just, and then you pass in A and B as parameters.
Okay.
And besides like return A comma or B comma A, like,
yeah,
is there any other way to just swap the values themselves? So to actually change A to B and then change B to A.
Isn't that what this does? I don't understand the distinction between this.
Okay, yeah.
And you could return A, B. Or, yeah, or you could just return B comma A, right, and not have this one. Okay. So, yeah. Yes.
In preparation for, there's a problem where you have a function and you want to be able to modify the second parameter while only passing one.
Yeah. Good question.
I like tried looking on the internet. I could not figure it out.
Okay. So.
Thinking of a pointer. But...
All right. Yeah, so I think, let me see if I can remember the question. I'm going to make something up that's similar. So I think it was a function that was like, okay, so let's define a function that adds two numbers. And we give them defaults, b equals 20, right? And we return A plus B, right? So these optional arguments, default values mean that we don't have to pass in all the arguments. We can just call plus with no arguments, and A is going to assume the value of 10, B is going to assume the value of 20, and it's going to return 30, right? That is what 10 is, right? Okay. If we do plus and we pass in a single argument, say 30, well, A is going to get this value because it's in the first place. B is going to be 20. 30 plus 20 is 50, right? I'm going to do one more case. Plus 1 and 2. Well, 1 is in the first place, so it goes to A. B, second place, goes there. So this is going to be 3. Does that make sense so far? Now, we're getting to the harder one. What? Did I mess up?
No, I think I figured it out.
Okay. All right, so your question, repeat your question and then say your answer.
So my question was, how do you pass only one parameter but modify B?
Uh-huh.
And I think the answer would be if you did plus and then the parentheses and then have nothing and then a comma and then.
Not quite, actually. No, you can't, I don't think that's syntactically valid. So what you're saying is that, let's say we wanted this to be 11, what we didn't want to pass, we wanted basically pass in B equals 1 and A equals 10, leave that as the default. That's basically what you want to do. You want to leave A as the default and just add 1 to whatever A is. Okay? So remember that what we talked briefly about last time, you can call plus and you can just specify one of them. You can just call them out by name. B is 1. That's how you do it. And so A is going to keep its default because you're saying this, even though it's in the first place, this is not going to be A. This is B. That's what I want. So I give the name of the parameter. This is going to take on 1. That's going to be still be 10. Does that answer your question? She was saying that, oh, maybe if you do plus blank, comma, and then one. But you don't do that. You just call out the parameter by name. Yeah.
I have a quick question. Is there not a big question where you have to find the number of arguments and the function received?
Okay. So when the function gets, so that's a question that I can't handle right now. So it's having to do with like, isn't that single star args, something like that? Oh, does it specify? Okay. So I think that was specifically the thing that I had in mind was if you had a function that was defined as def f and star args, and we want to count how many arguments were passed in, right? If the user could call f of 1, comma 2, comma 3, comma 4, comma 5, we want to know how many of those there are. When you get args, do you know what kind of object it is? It's a list. Do you know how do you get the number of elements in a list?
Just four things in the list.
I heard that. So she said len. The len function tells you how many things are in a list. What? Yeah. Oh, I did today?
Yeah.
Okay. Does that answer your question? So basically, we just take len inside the function, return len of args.
Yes. So I actually passed in the swap to like.
And it didn't work.
Yeah, it didn't work.
Let me take a look at that because I was saying I don't know exactly what syntax it's going for. So let me go for it. It's possible it might want you to return negative one if it's less than zero if it's equal to and positive one if it's greater than. So let me take a look at that. It depends. Getting confused with Java a little bit as well. Yes. Yeah.
So there's this called defining scope. Like there's an I equals to 5 in front of the definition of the function, and there's an I equals to 6 before the calling of the function. And when it print the I equals to 5.
Yes.
So can you clarify what does it mean by defining scope?
Okay. Well. I'm going to try to use a bolder marker because I realize this might be hard to see. Got basically a purple background now. Okay. So she's saying it's got, oh, that's much better. I is 5, and then we have a function. Let's forget, it doesn't really matter what it does. Let's print out I. Okay? And then we say I equals 6, and then we call the function. And so let's predict what the output is going to be. Is that a representative example? Syntax. I is 5. So when we define the function, I is 5. I has changed to 6, but when we define the function, f only knows the value of 5. It basically substitutes in the value of I before, at this point, it substitutes in the value. It's not an argument to the function, right? It's defined before it. So it's going to take whatever value we had now, and that's what it's going to remember. And so when you call f. And so that's sometimes actually how lambda functions have been used in the past, in other languages, the equivalents, but it's not needed in Python because this can be inside the function and there can be scripts. So, yeah. Does that kind of answer your question then? Okay. Yeah.
If there was.
Can I give you a ticket? I forget when I walk over there.
Yeah. So instead of f of parentheses, if you just put print I after that, would it print 6?
Oh, no, certainly. If you just put print I, yeah.
Okay.
If you call print I down here, I is going to have changed. But yeah, calling the function is not exactly like just typing out what it says.
Does it have to do with local variable and global variable? Well, sorry. Local value and global value.
You two? I asked if I gave you one. Okay. Okay. Does it have to do with local versus global variable? In Python, let's see. I mean, I guess you could consider a global variable to be one that's defined outside of any function. I mean, yeah, I is in that case kind of like a global variable if this is just at the beginning of the script. and it took on the value of it, but I'm not sure if that's the concept we're going for here. While I is a global variable, that's not why it took on the value, it remembered the value here. That's just how when you define a function, it looks for the variables in the namespace, it finds it substitutes in their values and uses that. It could have been a local variable, it could have been a field. It's not because it's a global variable. Yeah. Yeah, so we're getting into a little bit more detail on, you said looks it up in the single table, and because it's a scripted language. Yeah, kind of, because it remembers its state, the interpreter does, and so it kind of remembers, oh yeah, I is 5, it finds it, and substitutes that in when you're defining the function. So yeah, in that case, I mean, you see some things in Python like this that you don't encounter as often in other languages, so. And that's probably because it's interpreted, yeah.
What other questions are there? Kind of ignore the side of the, sorry, you're applying this column, I don't see you as well. Ready for the quiz? All right, so the password is, MPHG, Monty Python, the Holy Grail. Please do not use other references, so don't use the preparation document or other materials. The answers to the quizzes are always supposed to come just from your brain, okay? Was it about the content? We're done with that.
No.
Okay, so go to the 12th site. You should be able to do this.
Yeah, so do the 10 a.m. class.
Yeah.
Who needs more time on the quiz? Raise your hand, please, if you do. We won't talk about the quiz right now, but we are going to move on and answer one of the questions, some of the questions that were asked. If there are any more questions after this about the star arcs and double star arcs, ask me. But I wrote up a quick little example here to go over that. Can you see this okay? Do I need to make it bigger for those in the back? This is okay? Okay, I'll make it a little bit bigger. So here in this notebook, I have used a star argument, right? Variable number of arguments, and I'm just returning the length of args. Turns out args is not a list. That was what was said. It's a tuple. They're very similar. Tuples are immutable. Lists are mutable, so you just can't change args once it comes in. But I pass in three arguments. It tells me there are three arguments. Okay, so that's how star args works. Single star args and then double star args. This is totally fine. Because it knows when you give a name to a parameter or an argument. When I say x gets 10, that's how it knows that we're in the double star args. Because look what's happened. The first three arguments are passed in without names, and so it tells me there's three of them. And then it tells me how many arguments are there in the double star args. It knows there's only one because there was only one that was passed in with a name. And they're different types. So we said that the regular args is, the single star args is passed in as a tuple. The double star args is a dictionary. And I don't think dictionaries you've gotten to in detail yet, but you can see I've just asked it to print out args too, and it says, oh, there's this thing x, and it has a value of 10. So I don't, did we get the dictionaries? No. So we'll see dictionaries soon. They're very similar to maps in other languages. But that's how it works. Basically, you tell it a name that you want to pass in for that argument. It's sometimes used in programming, like for, I'm just familiar with sci-fi, scientific computing. If you want to pass in some optional options, and there are certain names for them, sometimes that's what it's used for. These aren't super common. You don't have to include them in your code. I don't think ever in an assignment you're going to have to do these things. But these are options that you have. Yes?
So in the reading, it talks about the arbitrary argument list as something that you write out to a file. Was that just like a very specific example?
I think it was a very specific example.
Okay.
So let's look at the reading. So I was just looking here. Oh, yeah, it was just writing multiple items to a file. That was a specific example.
Okay.
And notice how in this it has the star args at the end. So that was another question. You put the regular ones that you have names for and that you want to take separately, and then you can put the star args. And I'm not sure whether you can switch the order of the star args and the double star args too. I'm not sure. Okay. Cool. Yeah. Yeah, sure. We can change things and play with it if you like. Yeah.
So is the x equals 10 is like after the tuple star arc, so you like, so it makes it to dictionary, but if it's in front, it would be like a variable? Yeah.
Let's check it out. Actually, I'm not sure if it's going to let me. So like, let's say if I did cast this in front. If I do this, I think it's going to say, oh, there's no star args, because everything is named, and there's two double star args. I think that's what it's going to do if I do this. Yep. So in this case, there's zero in args, and there's two in args too. Now, if I then started messing around, you know, adding additional things, 1, 2, 3, I don't know if this is going to work. Yeah, there's an error here. It's because you're supposed to pass in these ones first. But in this case, we reverse the order. It doesn't have to do. Okay? Yeah.
Is it because we defined it as the one star first and the double
star
first?
Yeah, and I think that's what she was saying, is you have to. You have to do it in this order. The star args has to become before the double star args. So play around with this stuff, right?
write a notebook yourself and start playing around with it. See if you can build a mental model for what's going on. It explains the rules and then try it out. That's going to be a pretty important thing. Because we're covering, just, and that's because we're covering a lot of material. I want to spend the time on the things that we're going to use later on, but also the things that are conceptually difficult. This is kind of like, you know, rules. You know, how is the language going to behave? It's a little bit particular to the language, you know, as opposed to concepts. All right, so let's get into the lecture. So intended learning outcomes, by the end of today, I want you to be able to write Python programs using the equivalence of all of your favorite control flow statements, which is things that change the way that the program executes. Normally, programs are executed line by line by line by line, right? But with if statements, you use this line to execute based on a certain condition or for loops. You know, you don't go line by line. Well, within the for loop, you do it, and you go back to the beginning, right? They're called control flows because they affect the control flow of the program. Use the range function to compactly define an arithmetic sequence of numbers. That means an arithmetic sequence is a sequence in which you start with a number and you add a certain number to that every time. So if I have an arithmetic sequence starting at 3 in increments of 2, then it's 3, 5, 7, etc. to a certain amount. And range can compactly do that. You can generate those numbers without typing them out or without writing a for loop. The range function does that for you. I want you to be able to write and call functions that accept the variable number of arguments. We've talked about a lot about that. And then default values for formal parameters. There was a good example that we did about that. Default values. And then lambda functions. You're going to get some, if you do the homework for today, you could get a little practice with lambda functions. I don't require that you use the lambda expressions, but it could be pretty nice. And then follow recommended coding style, including Reddit descriptive documentation strings. I don't require that you comment your code in this class. I comment my code. I think I do a pretty good job of it. And I've had to write doc strings when I want to submit something to a repository online or to a code base online. They require very specific formats. But I don't require that of you because I feel like it's very important. But, you know, if you're going to just program for yourself, I think that either you're probably going to realize that you should have written comments later. And so I'll let you learn from your own experiences. Oh, I should have commented my code because now it looks like total gibberish to me. Or if you're going to work for an organization like as a developer, they're going to require that you write comments in a specific way. And so I'm not sure that my way of writing comments is going to help you towards that. So that's my rationale. I don't require comments. But I do highly recommend it. So some thoughts of readings. Yeah, I said that it's not a list, but it's a tuple when you have a star arbitrary. But don't worry about that yet. You haven't seen tuples or dictionaries yet. You also don't know how to take command line input. I think there was a little bit about calling a Python script from the command line. We haven't talked about that. Don't worry about it. Actually, I'm kind of surprised. The Python tutorial hasn't talked about that yet and then starts using it. Oh, maybe it did in the first chapter and we just skip that part because I don't think I ever do that. Yeah, we'll talk about lambda functions in the class, in the slides. And the meaning of slicing in Python, by the way, is totally different from the meaning of slicing in C++. Has everybody dealt with the quiz? Anybody still working on it? Okay. Slicing is totally different in Python. Slicing is when you have a list or a tuple or any iterable thing, and you use a certain syntax to describe, I want these elements, several elements at a time, not just a single element, right? In C++, you've got an array, in Java you try an array list, something like that. And you just ask for a single item, right? You pass in one subscript. In Python, there's a certain notation to allow you to get multiple subscripts at once. It's very similar to actually how MATLAB can do it. Does anyone know if you can do that in R? Because I know some of you know R. Yeah, can you do that? Yeah, so it's similar to that. All right, so let's talk about lambda expressions versus regular functions, right? We call a regular function, like printf, give the argument. Let's see what that function looks like. Def f of x. So we're going to pass in 2, it's going to go into this x, and it's going to take 2 squared and add 1 to it. It's going to return 5, right? And we call that. We call, well, def is a keyword. It's part of the language, right? This is our function name. This is our parameter that we're taking in. We can have multiple ones. We can have a star args. It doesn't have to be args, by the way. You can call it star x. But now x is going to have all those multiple arguments, right? It doesn't matter what the name is. We've given the parameter a name. And then we have to have a colon at the end for lambda expressions, because colon is kind of used. Colon in conjunction with a tab is what Python uses in place of, say, curly braces that you see in C++. We have another keyword. You have to include that return there. And this is what we want it to return. We want it to evaluate return. Now, in regular functions, I could also have other lines here, right? They could be multi-lines long. And at the very end, you have your return. Or that's when the function stops executing. Here's the equivalent lambda function for that. F gets lambda x, no parentheses. I made that mistake just a second ago, my bad. And then we have x squared plus 1. Some things you'll notice about it. Well, here's our function name in this case, or the variable that it's saved in. So I guess you could think about, well, does a variable, a function have a name, or do you just have a reference to the function? And I guess that's maybe the more appropriate way to do it. F is the reference to the function, but it doesn't matter. You call it f of x, and that's all that we really care about. We have another keyword, lambda, and we're using that instead of that. We have the parameter that you want to take in, or multiple parameters. I'm not sure if you can have a star args in the lambda function. I don't remember. Probably. Got a colon, as usual, but you don't have to go over the next line. The lambda functions have to be, I think they can only be one line long. You're supposed, I don't think you can break to the next line and go on. Or at least that would not be good style, because then why are you writing a lambda function? Just write a regular function. And this is what you want to evaluate. So it's just two different ways of writing the exact same thing. Does that make more sense now? Answer questions? Any more questions about lambda functions? I think the more confusing thing is that in either case, we can pass f, the function handle, or reference to that function, into another function, which is what we'll do for the sort function. And maybe I'll figure that out. Well, we'll figure that out together if I get through the rest of the slides. Otherwise, I'll post something about that today. Let's talk a little bit about references and mutability. I posted a video about this a little bit, so maybe yeah, we'll go through this. Let me see what other slides we've got. Yeah, okay. References and mutability. So similar code can behave differently depending on whether the variable is a value or a pointer or reference or mutable and immutable. So let's take an example from C++. Because I think everybody is most familiar with C++ at this point. What is this code going to print out? I'm going to give you 20 seconds to think about it. Okay, who's got an answer? Let's go through it. So let me say one. So we've got this variable in C++. We've got a variable x, right? It's going to store the value 1. We've got a variable y. It's going to store the value f. It's in x currently. So it gets, looks at x, says there's a 1 there. So I copy it into there. We say y gets 10. Okay, change y. We see out x, prints out 1. Good. What if we have this in C++? Give me 10 seconds to think about that. Okay, what's the answer in this case? Still one? Draw it. Say, here's our x, right? 1. We've got an integer reference, y. So this is not an integer itself. It's just a reference. So okay? Y gets 10. This is how I draw it, because Y really just refers to X. It's an alias for X. Whenever we change Y, we change X. So when we change Y gets 10 in this case, because this is a reference, X gets 10. Does that make sense? This is familiar from C++. If it's not familiar from C++, then it's something that we should talk about in octagons. In Python, all variables are references to objects. Even an int is an object under the hood, it turns out. But they're immutable. And so they end up working just like integers in C++. So let's take a look at what would happen in C++. I guess this is Python code. Okay? So now we're going to talk about something that can happen in Python. Okay, so we've got X is, oh, let's see if you can figure this out. I'll give you 20 seconds to think about this one. What's it going to bring to this one? Y element 1 gets 10. That means Y element 1 changes to 10. And if we print out X, well, X is pointing to the same thing, so it's going to print out 1 comma 10. So this is a little bit unusual if, that sort of makes sense. Some types like, okay, so this is showing you for a mutable object in Python, which is in this case a list, that we've got references to the same object, and even though it looks like we're changing Y, we're also changing X, it turns out, just like if Y was a reference to C++. That's the point here. Do you have a question? Do you have a question over here? All right, but some things like ints, floats, and strings are immutable in Python. This makes them behave like terminators in other languages. And so let's give this example in Python. All right? As I don't want you to get confused about this, even though they are objects, technically, they behave like primitives. So if they behave like primitives, right, then this code looks exactly like this code did without the ampersand, right? And we say that by changing X, we're not changing, or by changing Y, we're not changing X, right? Just primitives in this C++ example, X was 1 even afterwards, right? In this case, it's going to behave exactly the same way, even though the Python integers are objects. Let's see how this works, okay? It works because we have X, and we have its object, 1, Y is just a reference to that. But when we say Y gets 10, it doesn't change this integer, because the integer is immutable. It can't be changed. And so what it means when you say Y gets 10 is create a new integer object that gets 10 in it, and change Y pointing over to it. So when something is immutable, and it turns out that it technically behaves kind of like primitives in C++, but then for things that are mutable, you need to be careful about, am I modifying it, or am I creating a new instance of it? Yeah?
So say, for example,
if
you have a list that is mutable, and then you want, let's say, for Y1, you want to modify it to 10, but not change.
But you're going to have to create a copy.
Yeah,
so she's saying, well, what if I wanted to modify just Y and not X here? Well, then you shouldn't have assigned Y gets X, because that ties them together.
Okay.
Yeah, so you would have had to create a copy.
So
okay.
If I
And there are ways of creating copy. You can, well, we can talk about that later, but what? The slicing would work. So here's one simple way of creating a copy to make y equivalent to x. You can say y gets x, and here's the slicing, all the elements inside it. And that'll create a copy, because slicing does. So sometimes those rules get interesting. Did you get a thing on it? If you directly assign a list to y, if you have a list on the right-hand side, that is creating a new list. So it is going to separate y from x effectively. So she's saying if you've got something like 10, 2, and you can't say y. Well, you could say that. Oh, that's actually kind of interesting. So it turns out you could have y subscript 1 being a list. You can have a list of lists. In this case, this is going to change x and y. But if we just said y gets that, well, then y is now going to take on this new list. Okay. There's some back here. Yeah? You first.
So in the terms of the question C,
yeah.
Could you reiterate when exactly y is making the copy? So is it in the second line when y equals x, is it pointing to 1, or did it create
a new
one?
Yeah, at this point, okay, so
it's still pointing
here,
to 1.
At that point, y was still pointing over to 1.
And then it switches to 10.
And then once we get to this line, that means create this new 10 and point over to that instead.
So is it integers? Like, what should we know is immutable and mutable? So
integers,
are immutable.
Strings, floats.
Right, and then lists are mutable.
What's that?
Like lists and...
Lists are mutable. Tuples are immutable. We haven't talked about tuples yet, but tuples are immutable.
Okay.
Yeah?
So the reason if you just say y equals 10, 2, that I create some new thing is that it's sort of like the entire list is immutable. The entries are immutable. Is that sort of right? Like you can change an entry, but you can't just say, yeah, I'm going to change the entire list.
Let's see. So... Yeah, sorry, it's getting a little confusing because we are talking about lists of lists. Well, can you give me the code to write and then I can answer your particular question?
Oh, sorry, just y equals, like you said, phrase
yeah.
10, comma 2.
Okay, no
one.
For this.
No one, yeah.
Okay.
And then over there.
Yes, 10 comma
2.
Yeah. And that's because y is just the reference. We're not looking at any particular element of it. But we're saying this reference should now point to a list, 10, comma 2. And I seem to get you to take it way back there. Yeah?
Yep. So it is the case for
I have.
So it's the case before that you create a list of this. If I want to change the
Okay, you're saying this. So let's draw this out so we're not confused, okay? So let's we've got this object here. It was x is 1, 2, and then we said y gets x. And now we're changing y element 1 to 10, 2. Or, yeah. Right? Okay, list of lists. Or list with an integer and a list.
Say you do that, and if you want to change the value of 10, how would you do it?
You need to play around with that. I'm going to let you play around with that yourself. Write this code yourself and see if you can figure that out. What you want to do is you want to access the first element of the outer list, index 1, and then you want to access the 0th element of that. That's conception. It's going to be the same as like it would be in C++, except you can't have multiple types in C++. This is y gets the integer that is currently at x, 1. The subscripting creates a copy, always. So it does not refer to that position in the list. It's because subscripting or slicing, you know, slicing is as a way of subscripting, creates a copy of the data. Yes.
Just one side, you know, because if you did that, you need a string here, what would you like, why? Good, that's why.
Strings are immutable, so we wouldn't have been able to do this sort of thing.
But you would, if you do like, just why, if you don't, then that's really like creating.
You can create a new string, okay. Try it. All right, it's 10:15, so I'll let you guys go. Know that you've got an assignment. Typically, this is going to be a flipped classroom sort of thing, but we went a little bit long on questions. I hope that was helpful. You're welcome to start on the assignment. You've got 2 times to do. 2 measurements. By the way, take a look at the slides online if you want a challenge to do that's not the assignment.
I'm going to go to the next one.